Now, very few considerations from the geology perspective of the flow simulation new frontiers. So, these new frontiers try to overcome the criticalities of the single medium and dual media approaches. The dual porosity approach is quite dated, going back about to the 70s of the former century, and relies on a kind of abstract idealization and simplification of the real fracture system. The matrix and fractures are treated as separate entities in each cell, where the rock matrix blocks described by a kind of sugar cube geometry are surrounded by the fractures. This approach is considered by some experts as too simple, primitive, inadequate to effectively handle the geological complexity of the real fracture network. In particular, the fracture permeability description at grid model cell scale of observation, based on upscaling process like ODA, is considered not adequate for taking into account the actual fracture connectivity and thus not able to capture the channeling behavior. Considering the very high uncertainties affecting the discrete fracture network, a very simple way to face these issues has been, in the past, that of increasing the horizontal grid resolution to try to capture more accurately the fracture corridor, that means discriminate between fractures versus not fractures area, and minimizing the homogenization generally observed. Of course, the drawback to face is the high computational cost due to the large number of grid cells. However, the new frontiers would be that of moving from the simplified sugar cube geometry to an explicit description of both the real matrix blocks and the fracture system, to describe more effectively the fluid flow with a more geologically meaningful model. The drawback of this method are the difficulty of meshing this kind of complex three-dimensional fracture network, as well as the high computational cost, due to the large number of grid cells and also the convergence problems. In fact, these issues make the application of this approach not yet feasible at present at large field scale. In front of these scenarios, from the geologist's perspective, we should wonder case by case what is our real knowledge of the geological complexity. It is adequate to describe in a reliable way the fracture network in the infra-well space? What is the actual granularity of our knowledge? What is the scale and the level of detail in the set of available data? Are we able to create and populate in a reliable way a very detailed model? In fact, this kind of model would call for details that risk to largely surpass our actual knowledge of the geology of the fracture system and to lead to the building of very detailed models that are extremely sensitive to very small incorrect reservoir description coming to result totally unreliable. This issue could be minimized only considering a very large number of realizations to try to face the uncertainty, but again, with a high computational cost. Definitely, we must be aware of our real knowledge of the reservoir. At present, some possible alternatives to the standard dual porosity dual permeability approach could be clustered dual porosity dual permeability approach, embedded discrete fracture modeling, a dual porosity dual permeability approach coupled with the embedded discrete fracture modeling. The idea of clustered DP dual porosity dual permeability approach is to separate disconnected fractures cluster by means of transmissibility barriers at the relevant simulation grid cells interface. Using a standard dual porosity dual permeability approach, The fractures in the cells highlighted in red will be put likely in communications. Presuming of identifying the two independent fracture cluster, that is actually a very uncertain task, in the clustered dual porosity dual permeability approach, the two fractures cluster will be separated. This is performed defining a fracture cluster identifier in the grid and checking values in neighboring cells. Whenever the cluster identifier of two adjacent fracture cells is not the same, a transmissibility multiplier equal to zero is set in the simulation at the interface between these two cells to try to account for the estimated connectivity of the fracture network. So, the fractures in the cells are highlighted in red will not be put in communication using the clustered dual porosity dual permeability approach. In the embedded discrete fracture model approach, the matrix is discretized using, as usual, a corner point geometry grid, while the fractures are considered embedded in such grid. This is achieved by adding auxiliary grid blocks to the original input grid in a number equal to the grid blocks intercepted by the fractures network. Such auxiliary grid blocks represent a number of supplementary cells used to simulate 2D flow inside each fracture, for which the estimation of permeability, actually very uncertain, has to be made. To account for the flow exchange between fractures and the matrix, a transmissibility link connecting the auxiliary grid block and its respective block in the original grid is considered using non-neighboring connection. Therefore, in the embedded discrete fracture modeling, each fracture is explicitly represented and the actual connectivity of the fracture network should be better honored. Clustered DPDK approach provides results similar to the embedded discrete fracture modeling approach in terms of pressure distribution in the fractures, and both the approaches are better in capturing the actual fracture connectivity with respect to standard ODAS DPDKs. In fact, the fracture permeability description at grid model cell scale of observation is more effective in capturing the channeling behavior. However, the uncertainties about the fracture connectivity is very high, and it is very difficult to have a reliable a priori knowledge, that means before a production history. In general, we can say that a dual porosity, dual permeability approach can be more appropriate in a context made by very high fracture intensity that makes the fracture system quite homogeneous. Instead, the channeling behavior is bound to become more and more significant when the fracture density decreases and it is affected by large fractures having very high extension and permeability. However, it is a scenario that could be inferred only a posteriori, that means after a production history. So a reasonable approach could be that of starting with a DPDK approach, trying to increase as much as possible the horizontal grid resolution, and then, based on the production history, decide if it will be appropriate to move to a clustered DPDK approach. In the last approach, the embedded discrete fracture modeling is added to the dual porosity dual permeability approach. The main advantage of coupling the DPDK and the embedded discrete fracture modeling approaches is the possibility of handling free media. In fact, in the DPDK plus embedded discrete fracture modeling approach, the first medium of the DPDK describes the matrix domain. The second medium describes the fracture communicating with the matrix through the transfer term T and the shape factor sigma. The third medium is represented by the embedded discrete fracture modeling auxiliary cells and describes the larger fractures connected via non-neighboring connection to the other two media, that are matrix and fractures, small fractures, let's say. This approach appears to be very interesting because it's able to handle a geological scenario, sometimes faced, made by two different fracture families related to different genetic mechanisms and so affected by different characteristics.